Oh, hello. You'll have to excuse me, I got something important to do. In the meantime, why don't you stick around and watch this review I made in advance? Enjoy! Today we are here to celebrate a very special war veteran, whose efforts helped in the Battle of the Atlantic, and whose efforts helped make the ocean a lot safer through his naval expertise. I am of course talking about the incredible Mr. Limpet. Why yes, he is a fish. What were you expecting, maybe a turtle? Get out! Fish heroes are the way to go. I'll be honest though, when I saw the DVD of this movie at my local Walmart, I could have sworn this was a Disney movie. But nope, this is a Warner Brothers movie that, like Disney, is doing that live-action cartoon character formula that I used to expect from Disney growing up. Either way, being from the 60s, I expect nothing less but a satisfying fun time. So let's look into the incredible Mr. Limpet and see what kind of fishy business he brings. We open at the Pentagon in 1964, where we see the Admiral, along with a character we'll see later named George, walking through an obvious fake set to a top secret room. They're trying to look for someone who supposedly disappeared in 1941 and is apparently teaching dolphins to be... like what now?
Tests every day are proving these sea creatures are so intelligent and possess such amazing faculties that they seem almost human. Even superhuman.
So yes, people, this person who we know is Limpet is the reason dolphins are so intelligent. Remember this when you actually see him. But now we flash back to 1941, where we see Mr. Limpet, played by the late Don Knotts. He desires to be part of the Navy, but can't because he's physically inept, and very nearsighted, not to mention socially awkward. Oh, and apparently he's so pathetic that he works with mostly old ladies. Yeah, if this were made now, the movie wouldn't make it to opening day due to the backlash of so many different gender rights groups.
I suppose we'll be losing you to the Navy soon, then.
I'm afraid not.
Really?
My eyesight and a few other things. I'm classified 4F.
Everybody can't be a hero, Mr. Limpet. We need men like you at home, too.
Why?
Well... to give to the blood bank, of course.
Well, they don't want my blood either.
He's that bad, huh? Well, it could be worse. He could also have some sort of nasty habit of some kind.
There's a fish in the water cooler!
I know, it's mine!
Ew! Yeah, he has a really bad obsession with fish, to the point where it's all he cares about. Don't believe me? Just wait. Anyway, we meet a younger George, who seems to be good friends with him. We also get to meet Limpet's wife, Bessie, played by Carol Cook. Now, I really don't understand why she would marry a guy who clearly has more interest in fish than he does with caring for her. Hell, she seems more interested in George, and we still don't know how they all know each other this well. Especially when their interests clash with one another.
Be like shaking a leg, Henry?
Oh, no thanks, George. I can't. I have this faulty equilibrium, you know, due to poor vision.
Henry, how many times must I tell you you do not rumble with your eyes?
Listen, I have an idea. Why don't we all go over to the university tomorrow for Professor Hoffmeyer's lecture?
Lecture?
Yeah, on decapods of the genera Pagurus. You know, George, he's gonna talk about the
mating habits of the shellfish.
Gee, sound familiar?
I got this one crazy video on the mating rituals of a hippopotamus.
Oh look, he even has his own evolution chart involving fish.
He claims millions of years ago there was nothing but fish in the world.
That's right. And then, you see, some of those ancient creatures, they became amphibians. And they crawled out on the land, you see. And then millions of years later, they became men.
You know, the more time they spend on developing him as a zealous fish fanatic, the less believable it is for him to even be married. It almost feels like his character is of the nerd stereotype, but as an adult. Where's the actual human side to him?
Fish have a better life than people.
I wish I were a fish, 'cause fishes have a better life than people.
Ah, there's that musical cue movies like this were known for. Ignore the light dimming, he's off in his own little world. Look at that face. That's the face that watches you whenever you swim in dreamland.
Henry, the water! Henry Limpet, you are floating yourself right out of your happy home with this crazy hobby of yours.
Now, Bessie, I'm going to run right down to the pet store, and I'm going to get a new regulator for the intake hose.
And while you're going, you be sure and take all of this junk with you. The fish, the tank, the bowls, the whole works.
You mean get rid of it?
You bet I do. Everything, out, out.
But Bessie!
Henry Limpet, either those fish go or I do.
Well, you are hitting on my best friend, so... Bye! Okay, no, he gets rid of them off-screen. Even now, he still values them over his wife. What a guy! They go to Coney Island for some nice relaxation, but Limpet is still upset because he still wants to enjoy being with his fishy friends, even having a book that says Theory of Reverse Evolution. Gee, I wonder what will happen.
I don't want to wait a million years to go back again. More than anything, I wish I could be one of you right now. I wish I were a fish.
Yeah, when has light like that ever been a good thing?
Henry! George Henry can't swim. Save him.
Oh, what'll we do?
Save him.
Get some help! Call the lifeguard! Get the police!
Or you could just get Hollywood security. After all, from the sound of things, you are inside a studio. So George tries and... Okay, really? But anyway, this is where the cartoon portion of the movie begins. Well, now we know how Archie came to be. He didn't die. He merely fell into some purple light in the water and became a cockroach through... reverse evolution?
He doesn't even know how to swim.
And Bessie thought I couldn't swim.
What a likable character. He turns into a fish, worries his wife half to death, and is completely fine with it. Yeah, he's a terrible person. That reaction was funny. I won't lie.
Bessie! What's gonna happen to poor Bessie?
Oh, now he cares? Took becoming a fish to make you realize you have a wife. Yeah, I'm still not buying it. So knowing that everyone thinks he's dead, he swims away while the same kind of musical vocals fill the screen. He starts communing with the fish, only to find that fish life isn't what it's cracked up to be. Why, not only is he ignored by the other fish, but he's already the target of a shark. What's that you said earlier?
Fish have a better life than people.
Hope you like reality biting you in the tail fin.
Jumping St. Elmo's fire! Who in blue blazes invited you in here? Slamming right into my private quarters? Come about and stand by for action, you four-eyed flounder!
This little Yosemite Sam wannabe is Krusty, voiced by the late Paul Frees. And for some reason, he sounds like he's speaking through a filter.
That does it. Put up your fins. I'm gonna swab the ocean floor with you.
Should I even bother putting in a clip for him?
Oh!
Did he just do a dragon shout? He did! Holy crap! The fish is dragonborn! But how in the world can he do that? I guess we'll never know outside of magic. Or science. Anyway, he befriends Krusty, who accompanies him on his journey to find others of his kind. They soon stumble upon an Allied forces ship that had sunk due to Nazi submarines. After seeing what he looks like and wishing he had another like him to talk to, he saves another fish from being pulled into reality and meets the pink doppelganger, who's more one-dimensional than you think.
Are you all right?
Oh, yes. Thank you.
Oh, well, gosh, that was nothing at all. I mean, nothing.
Oh, yes, it was. It was very nice of you. And very clever.
Say, does that mean that you like me?
Oh, yes, I like you very, very much.
But they just met. It looks funny the way he reacts, but still, after naming her Ladyfish, she...
Shall we go?
Go? Go where?
Why, to the spawning ground.
Okay, she's clearly acting on animal instinct, so I'll forgive her on that. But even then, Limpet, don't you think this means you'll be cheating on your wife?
You know what that dress reminds me of?
No.
First time I ever saw you. Remember? Your pop brought me home for dinner.
Oh, George, imagine you're remembering after all these years. Thank you. That was even before him.
Close enough. So the two spend some time together in a music sequence that's actually pleasant to listen to and nice to look at for 1960s standards.
You came to me just like the swell.
Minus stock footage.
Time, and suddenly how deep is the rapture.
When he remembers that he has a wife already, but when he tries to explain this to Ladyfish, she doesn't understand because she doesn't know how human relationships work since, well, she's a fish. That's to be expected. Thus, she leaves. Personally, I can't really feel bad for her because she's literally a fish. It's not like she's even hurt by this revelation. Maybe if this movie had better writing and made it so that she actually learns human emotion, then maybe react to something like this. It'd at least show someone actually developing in this movie. And of course, Limpet decides to cheat on his wife again as he goes after... Look at that face! Even without the water effects, it still looks too funny. So try as he might, he cannot find his newly beloved. But his underwater booms do attract... Nazis! Oh, and several months later, Pearl Harbor happened, as does this bad reversal effect. Anyway, this gives Limpet some inspiration to try and help out in the war despite being a fish whose only ability is an underwater boom. So I guess his solution is to find George. Oh, I wonder where this will lead to.
Hey, what's all this blabberdash about war and 4F and stickles and like that? Look, Flatbush, if you're in trouble, boy, you can count on me.
Well, if you'd stay here and act as my lookout for Ladyfish, I'd sure be grateful.
You only knew her for like 5 minutes! Maybe longer if the song sped up time for them, but... Jeez, you really are fish crazy if you ignore standard human relationships! He soon stumbles across a ship under attack by a U-boat, and without hesitating, tries to communicate with the humans on board.
Give the recognition signal!
I can't!
Give the recognition signal!
I'm Henry Limpet! I fell in the ocean and was drowned!
Hit him with a light.
Hit him with a light!
Give the recognition signal! Commence firing to starboard. Commence firing to starboard!
Yeah, that went well, but using the ship's sonar dome, he's able to get through to them and tell them where to fire at. And of course, it works. Still, Captain Harlock here is suspicious of what just happened.
You were trying to locate a submarine, weren't you? You couldn't find it, could you? And I told you where it was, didn't I? And then you got it, didn't you?
We cannot see you. How are you staying afloat?
Well, I'd rather not say at the moment you wouldn't believe me.
What the blasted blazes is this?
Oh, for the love of God, get up close to the ship so they can see you, and then they'll believe you. Not spotting you by the direction of your voice is one thing, but common sense, people. You have ears, use them. It doesn't change the Rear Admiral's belief that you're crazy, but still, at least you'll have some credibility in your crew. Other than that, he tells them that George is required out where the voice came from.
All right, Harlock. We'll arrange for your stickle to meet with this voice. But until we learn the true nature of this device, it will remain top secret.
It's not really a secret when the voice can be heard by the whole crew. So George goes out with them, who is rather frantic about being out here, and is forced to meet with the voice of his dead friend with a wife he's cheating on.
Henry? It's me, George Stickle.
I'm right here, George.
Look, if you're really Henry, what are you doing out here in the ocean?
Well, you remember when you jumped in the water after me at Coney Island?
Yeah, I sure do.
Didn't you see a fish?
I didn't. I thought it was wearing glasses just like yours. Only I was so upset it was just my imagination.
I suppose you'll have to see to believe. You can turn the light on me.
Oh my God, he's a ghost fish!
You remember how you used to come over to our apartment on Friday nights? You and Bessie would sit up till all hours playing poker while I read myself to sleep?
That's right. Regular as clockwork every Friday night.
And how about the time the three of us went to the Bronx Zoo? Remember? I got separated from you and Bessie and I had to walk home.
Only Henry Limpet would know all that. You are Henry!
So, anything about how he and Bessie got hitched? Maybe something dark about why she chose him over you? No? Well, whatever. Limpet asks him to speak to the Navy to let him help in seeking out Nazi U-boats, and even asks how Bessie is doing. So, I guess he does care after all, but it's still not very well clear given everything that's happened so far. But at any rate, despite whatever crazy case this is, Limpet is in. Both he and George are now part of the USS Destroyer.
Here's the hydrophone.
Oh, a water talkie. Thanks.
I love old live-action effect work.
Well, you can signal me through the ship's oscillator, and I'll signal you with my thrum.
Really? Thrum? I'm starting to think this is where Bethesda Studios got the idea for Thwoom. Anyway, alongside their new crew, they destroy many U-boats, which gets the Rear Admiral promoted to Admiral while upsetting the Nazis.
Diese unheimlich summende Ton. Und was ist dieser unheimliche summende Ton?
I think they left this unsubbed on purpose to make fun of how they speak.
Das Limpet. Slimpet? Was ist das Limpet?
Das war ein Befehl! Der Angriff steigert war ein Befehl!
So, from what I can make out, the Nazis have made a homing system that will allow them to track Limpet's thrum. At least they now have something to work with. But this would require every submarine to come back just to get new torpedoes, which would kinda leave you open, wouldn't it? Speaking of, the Navy is ready to escort a convoy over to Europe. Also, it seems Limpet got George to ask Captain Harlock to ask the Admiral to see about getting payments to his wife, and become a lieutenant.
Our secret weapon wants to be paid, and he wants a lieutenant's commission.
Then, Admiral Sputer, I suggest you pay him and commission him immediately.
Commission? Oh, but sir, you don't understand.
I understand the secret weapon is the most vital key to the safe conduct of our convoy. I order you to commission the secret weapon. Personally.
For a moment, it seems like he's channeling the pirate captain from the pirate planet. So Limpet becomes lieutenant, and Bessie gets paid for his services and starts to demand what is going on with her husband. This pretty much leads to nothing really important, as well as a musical dream sequence where Limpet is a national hero.
The other USA, it's a great celebration like the 4th of July.
Say, wasn't there a character named Krusty and some ladyfish we were supposed to care about? Well, there's Ladyfish, but that's only after the scene where Limpet loses his glasses to a manta ray knocking into him. Shouldn't you try thrumming for help? A little too soon, don't you think?
Ladyfish! Got a message for you from Limpet. He said he loved you and other such mush like that.
He loves me? Oh, he loves me.
Wait, you know what love is? I thought you were all about spawning and junk. Did you soak in what Limpet told you, or did the writers forget that you think like a fish? Either way, she and Krusty are back in the plot after, what, a half hour later? Well, okay, only Krusty is coming back. Ladyfish was just here to remind us that Limpet has a love interest now. That and escort him to where Krusty was.
Then I'm going with you too.
No, you can't. It's a very dangerous mission. Wait for me here, Ladyfish.
All right, cast off. Full speed ahead. No, hard aport. Full reverse. Come about full, then steady as she goes.
I'd always wait for you, Limp.
And yet your contribution to the story was minimal at best. After a crash course in fish wrangling, they catch up to the convoy, just as the Nazis arrive. They fire one of their new torpedoes and I guess Limpet figured out he could try using his thrum on it, which causes it to come his way. But with that in mind, they decide to fire torpedoes back at each other, while the convoy does nothing at all. Still, this is a pretty cool action scene. Thus, many Nazi officials lost their lives against one fish. Isn't that embarrassing? And thus, the US win the Battle of the Atlantic. Limpet goes to get new glasses from his wife and say his goodbyes.
Am I the widow of a man or the wife of a fish?
Well, now, let's be logical, Bessie. You couldn't very well keep me in the bathtub, could you?
I suppose not. No. Take care of yourself, Henry. Remember how you always catch cold when you get your feet wet.
Don't break up, Bessie. I'm just fine. Maybe all along I was meant to be a fish. Maybe nature just corrected her error.
Oh, so it was nature that brought the light of de-evolution down on you. What a load. Let's just say the water was radioactive and only he was affected. So the movie ends back in present day 1964, where they return to the spot they first found Limpet as a fish, where they give him the rank of Commodore and see whether or not he truly is involved with dolphins and... what's this? The end? Sequel bait that will never be realized? This movie is... fascinating, to say the least. I mean, it's no Mary Poppins or Bedknobs and Broomsticks, but For things they do wrong, they still manage to put out something that is mightily enjoyable to watch. I mean, as far as the concept goes, it's really silly, but it's almost like something you'd expect from this era of cartoon and live-action films. The humor is mostly from reaction shots and some dialogue exchanges, all to the absurdity of an idea that talking fish exists. Well, that, and the acting at times I found funny and odd. However, the characters are really lackluster in that we don't learn a whole lot about them, which makes me question how they got to these certain situations. Limpet especially, since he starts off as someone I couldn't sympathize with in his relationships, then suddenly heel turns back to a near human being, metaphorically speaking. The side characters especially have it bad, since they appear for a while, then disappear for a major portion of the film. It's like they couldn't find a way to incorporate them at all and instead give us filler. The animation portions tend to mix between good and repetitive, and while a lot of the live-action animation effects look impressive for the time, you can still see the mistakes they made. That and a few other cheap shortcuts that are easily noticed. In the end, though this movie is harmless enough to where it's viewable and it's a nice distraction for younger audiences, I wish it had better writing, though I am interested in seeing what they'll do in regards to the remake, if that ever happens, especially since Jim Carrey is apparently in it. I'm the Media Hunter. Media's my prey, and reviewing them my way.
I wish I were a fish. 'Cause fishes have a better life than people.
They don't have all the care and strife of people.
A fish can swim, that's all they ask of him.
A fish is free to roam around the sea and look for love wherever he can find.
Dieser unheimlich summende Ton.